Hello, I'd like to welcome everyone to the 10th episode of the second season of the Young Researchers Forum on Detonation. Today's presenter is Omar Dwina. Omar Dwina is currently a postdoctoral researcher in the CFD team at CERFAX in Toulouse, France, where he provides expertise in numerical modeling and theoretical analysis of reactor flows. Research activities have focused mostly on the safety-related combustion phenomena, such as chemical and thermal deflagration inhibition, flame acceleration, and the deflagration to detonation transition. He has recently extended his scope of research to include heat recirculation-based combustion technologies as part of an ERC project called SciRoCo, led by Professor Poinceau, and also pressure gain propulsion technologies as part of a project called INSPIRE, funded by the European Commission in 5 European countries. This talk will be recorded, edited, and posted on our website, which we'll post in the chat. Once the speaker approves the final version, there will be, there you can find previous talks and information about upcoming talks. Now, if you have any questions, I encourage you to ask them in the chat, and you can also ask them out loud anytime during the talk, or you can wait till the end of the presentation. So I'd like to welcome Omar Dwina. Thank you very much for presenting today, and welcome.
Well, thank you for the presentation, for the introduction. So basically, I'm gonna present some numerical simulations of DDT that we have performed in recent years at CERFAX. So it's a joint collaborative effort between all the people in this group: Thomas Jaravel, Anthony Mildaris, Olivier Vermorel, and Jerry Pont. So just a quick slide on detonation applications that are currently being investigated at CERFAX. So mainly we are interested in two topics: pressure gain combustors, which are of interest for us today, as part of a European project called INSPIRE. There is actually a brochure on the website of CERFAX if you are interested. So mainly the objective is to be able to simulate more accurately LDE combustors. And what I'm going to the subject that I'm going to tackle today is mostly related to safety. More specifically, I will talk about the influence of some numerical parameters and also some physical parameters. So it's really not a surprise for anyone that understanding explosions is of critical importance, mainly because of the tragic events that can come from these explosions in the industrial sites. And the problem is that, experimental investigations often unveil some trends, for example, the influence of mixtures, pressures, temperatures, and, for example, stratification, etc. But they are often not detailed and do not give sufficient insight into the DTT, the transition mechanisms. And that's the goal of the numerical simulations today, is to be able to identify precisely the key events precursor to DDT. And where I'm going, this is what we have been investigating in the past years. And mostly the content of this talk is based on mostly two papers that we've submitted recently. In the first one, we'll tackle a subject that is of critical importance in numerical simulations, mainly the influence of kinetics on DDT, on the DDT scenario. And in the second one, we'll tackle some problems that are not often addressed in the literature, mainly the chaotic, how numerical simulations can address the chaotic nature of DDT and the DDT tracking using some post-processing tools or some new technology, some new new methods. So regarding the influence of kinetics on DDT, the motivation behind this work was basically lies in this graph. What you are seeing here is the example. It's a stoichiometric as the air hydrogen air mixture at 1 atm, and what we are looking at is the characteristic time scales as function of temperature. Here, tau e refers to the induction time, and tau I to the induction time, and tau e to the excitation time. And we have considered two chemical schemes. The 9S18R is a detailed chemical scheme. It's based on the Boivin work. It contains 9 species and 12 reactions. But the first one is called 3S1R, and it's a one-step scheme used classically in the numerical investigation of DDT. Basically, you can see the calibration methods invoked in Oran et al. Papers. And we wanted and the whole motivation lies in the temperature dependence of the ignition time. You can forget about the values. The most important thing here is how tau I evolves the temperature. And as you can see, there is a drastic difference between the detailed chemical scheme and the one-step scheme. The one-step scheme is in dashed line here, and the detailed chemical scheme is in solid line. As you can see, is the absence of what we can call a cutoff temperature. Basically, what it means is that ignition is still possible with one-step schemes, even at relatively low temperature, for example, in diffusion here, whereas in the detailed chemical scheme, it is not possible. So basically, it invokes the hotspot consideration. Mainly, we assume that the DDT is often occurs inside the hotspot. And it may suggest that using calibrated one-step schemes without taking care of the existing, without taking into consideration the ignition delay times, can lead to easier to a propensity of the one-step scheme to easily ignite hotspots. More details can be found in the paper. So based on this observation, we propose to investigate the chemical scheme using the Graven database. It's basically a channel, an obstructed channel. It's 5.4 meters long, what's important, and with the blockage ratio of 30%. What's important is that they've investigated the influence of the mixture for ice to air, the influence of the equivalence ratio. And basically, there is an equivalence ratio above which DDT is often observed, which is here. So we've selected the one that where DDT can be observed. It's the one at equivalence ratio. What you are looking at here is the front velocity at the exit of the obstacle. So basically, if you are below DCG, you didn't have DDT inside the obstacle region. And we chose this configuration to investigate this point. So I'm going to go to the details of the numerical setup. So basically, we didn't have at the time IMR. So we've used a new strategy based on static meshes between interpolation. So basically, when we have a series of meshes with two regions, one fine region that you can see here, and one coarser region. This defined region is across four obstacles. And when the flame reaches the middle of this region, we interpolate and we go to the second mesh, et cetera, et cetera. So it involves interpolation, but it's most costly. It's more costly because you don't have you refine everywhere, but it has the advantage of having a good resolution even far downstream of the flame. So it's very good. Basically, very quickly, we have used only adiabatic non-sepals, and we use the same scheme that I've introduced before to investigate the influence of the chemical scheme on the DDT results. So as a validation, what you are looking at here is the reactive front speed as function of its position. For both, so in the envelope here is the experimental data. And the dashed line corresponds to the detailed chemical scheme, and the solid line corresponds to the one-step chemical scheme. So very quickly, regarding the flame acceleration stage, it's actually very well reproduced by both chemical schemes. Here I put some pictures for three consecutive obstacles at the at times corresponding to the time where the flame arrives at each obstacle. And what you can see is basically all the ingredients of flame acceleration that we all know: rapidly increasing turbulence, shock formations, and shock flame interaction, and a combination of flow contraction, turbulence, and shock flame interaction can lead to strong flame acceleration. But what interests us today is really the DDT location, what I highlighted here in the graph. Well, the DDT itself and its position is reasonably well reproduced by both schemes compared to the experiment. But surprisingly, the DDT position obtained with the detailed chemistry was lower than that observed with one same scheme. So it requires a more in-depth investigation of this phenomenon. So if you concentrate on the one-step scheme, here is a picture corresponding to the time locus of the DDT. Here you can see the flame brush, and you can see the DDT onset location here close to the obstacle. So basically, the DDT occurs close to the obstacle and far ahead of the flame front, which seems to suggest the involvement of a hotspot near the walls. And this is confirmed in the graphs here. So basically, it's a closed zoom close to the obstacle. Here is the dashed frontier here corresponds to the wall. And what you can see is an incident shock which gets reflected, interacts back with another compression wave, and leading to the formation of a region of hot and compressed gases, and detonation onsets from this region. But more importantly, if you I'm not going to go to the details of this, but if you investigate the temperatures of this at which this DDT occurs, on the temperature of the hotspot prior to DDT, what you realize is that the temperature are relatively low, 800 to 850 Kelvin. So it confirms what we were expecting. The one-step scheme has a propensity of igniting hotspots even at less restrictive conditions, let's say. But when we move to the detailed chemical scheme, what we end up looking at is that the DDT onset seems to be very close to the wall, okay? But it also seems to involve the flame front, which may explain why the DDT locus was observed earlier than in the one-step scheme. And if you look at the details of the different events that occur prior to DDT, what you look at here is the gradient of pressure indicative of shock compressions. And what you can see first, so we look at the window in red here. And what you can see is that there is an incident shock, which is precursor to the flame arriving in this location. And what you can see is basically the reflection of this shock with the reflection of this shock and the reflected shock wave interacting back with the flame front. This interaction leads to the trapping of the shock between the flame front and the wall, which leads to coherent energy release and the formation of pressure pearls and DDT afterwards. So basically what we have found out, we can have more details on all these mechanisms in the paper, but basically what we have found is that there is indeed a drastic influence of the chemical scheme on the DDT position and also on the DDT scenario, which actually begs the question of what are the minimum requirements that a chemical scheme must satisfy to be eligible for DDT simulations. In my view, this suggests to include ignition delay criteria in the chemical scheme calibrations or moving out from the one-step scheme conservation. But also, we have to state that behind this result, there is also a hidden truth, is that this result may even be may also be due to the chaotic nature of the DTT scenario itself. So what we wanted to do after this first results is to have more more control on the DDT scenario. So basically, what we wanted to find is our experiments in where the locus of the detonation is better controlled. The problem is that when you try to find experiments, very well documented experiments, you find out that it's very difficult to have experiments that offer large diagnostics and more and detailed diagnostics. The problem that the conditions that we wanted to satisfy wanted this experiment to satisfy is to obtain fast frames very rapidly, so that to decrease the computational cost, and an experiment in which the DDT scenario and or at least the fast frame can be reached in a controlled position, so that we can have this we can have more diagnostics and more experimental data. And we finally found a very good experimental work that was performed by Saif et al. At the Ottawa University. Behind this work lies a very simple idea, is to artificially reproduce the fast frame propagation regime by simply attenuating a detonation wave by putting an obstacle ahead of it. So it's a shock tube experiment. And we have different stages of propagation. So the first one, in the first sections here that I don't show, you have a DDT and a detonation propagating in a smooth channel. And this detonation will end up interacting with an obstacle with different blockage ratio, which will lead to the quenching of the detonation. And in this whole region, we will have, in the same window, diagnostic window, a fast flame regime in which DDT can be observed. And it's actually very interesting. This is an example of with methane air, but they methane oxygen, but they investigated the other mixtures, other fuels. But what is really interesting in this experiment is that you can the computation setup is actually very well defined. It doesn't involve a very long channel, so it's in terms of computational cost, it's very good. And these experiments are still very relevant, because in many situations when you look at DDT, you observe that there is often the CG defragmentation regime is often observed prior to DDT. So this, while simplifying the computational domain, these experiments still are very relevant to the DDT scenario. So they provide well-controlled experiments and detailed visualized diagnostic, which are very very interesting in terms of numerical validation. And also, as I said, the small configuration are ideal for DDT simulations, and to run multiple simulations so as to address the influence of different key parameters. And of particular interest for us is the influence of, for example, the influence of key parameters like pressure and blockage ratio on the distance to DDT. In other words, the distance between the cylindrical the obstacle and the reinitiation of the detonation wave. So basically, I'm going to go very briefly about the numerical setup. So we are using the AVP solver like before, developed at Cerfax. We are using 2D triangular meshes like before, with a fine mesh, We have performed also mesh conversions on these results, and we have chosen to handle shocks via an artificial viscosity. You can look at the work of Schmidt et al. To see how this works, and we have investigated several points, four initial pressures, and two blockage ratio. And we have only considered the methane oxygen mixtures for now, but it will be the subject of further investigation. And because we are in a region, DDT will be caused by a region of high temperature. Actually, we end up in a situation where we can easily tune the one-step chemical scheme to reproduce also the ignition delay times obtained with the detailed chemical scheme. So that's another advantage of this experiment. And this is what we have basically done. We have tuned the one-step chemical scheme to match the CG detonation velocity, the half reaction thickness, and also the flame speed for fast flames. So what we mean by fast flames each time are flames that are at post-shock conditions, both in terms of temperature and pressure. And something that I want to stress today is regarding the chaotic nature of DDT. In terms of initialization, we chose not to start with the ideal CG detonation. What we did is basically the following. We have first simulated a 2D detonation front in a channel without the obstacles, so that you have a well-established detonation, 2D detonation. And we have took this established detonation, and we have simply interpolated in our mesh with the cylinders, upstream of the cylinders. And a very natural question that arises now is: will the results be dependent on the time at which I will take, for example, my established detonation? So what we have decided to do is to use an ensemble realization procedure, which is basically what it means is that we have taken the detonation front at five different times, the established cellular detonation at five different times, and we have considered the influence of these five times on the DDT result. So this is an example of two successful reinitialization. So it's the same pressure, the same blockage ratio, but we have simply taken the detonation, the established detonation, cellular detonation at two different times. And what you can see is that simply by doing this, you can end up with a considerable influence on the DDT scenario and on the DDT position. This is in the video, but we can actually focus on the DDT event. What you can see is that in the first realization, what you end up observing is that the DDT occurs close to the wall, okay, and arises from the wall. But in the second realization, the DDT occurs and at the middle of the computational domain. While both involve shock reflections and transverse shocks, you can see from the videos that the detonation locus itself is different. When we adopted the strategy, we confronted all these simulations to the experimental results, and this is what we've done here for multiple operating points. So here we investigate only one blockage ratio at 75%, and we compare the experiments, which are the symbols in square symbols, and the simulations, which are in solid lines, and you can see the envelope of the results on the field surface. So basically, our numerical simulation showed that there are a reasonable variation in the DTT locus depending on the time at which the detonation front has been chosen. But all in all, we are able to capture the DTT position reasonably well. And this is true for all the pressure operating points that we have considered. And what is also observed is that we are able to reproduce the effect of the pressure that is observed in the experiments, mainly the fact that as we lower pressure, we lower the excitability of the mixture, and we lower the distance to DDT. And when we move to higher blockage ratio, what we also represent well the experiments, and we also represent we also are able to reproduce the fact that for different pressures we may end up not observing DDT or observing DDT depending on the blockage ratio. And what is interesting is that we also are able to reproduce the decay of the reactive front if no DDT is observed. So basically, if I can sum up the paper, our results so far, is that we are able to reproduce the pressure trends observed in the experiments, and also the effects of the blockage ratio. And we have also managed to come up with a procedure that can allow to assess or to address and to quantify the chaotic nature of DDT, if you can say it like this. And I'm going just to talk briefly about some work that we have done in the paper as well to track the detonation onset more in details. So what we wanted is a local criterion to identify the wave propagation regime that can be that we will use afterwards and can be useful for modeling purposes. And it's based on the SEMA procedure. So SEMA is for chemical explosive mode analysis. I will present it very briefly here, and that I will show the results that we've obtained to track DDT inside the in our computational results. So SEMA is actually based on the governing equation of chemical system. So basically, you divide your you look at the thermochemical at your chemical thermochemical state, and what we want to look at is the chemical Jacobian of the system. And basically, what you want to know is the largest eigenvalue corresponding to this Jacobian, which basically represent the most explosive eigenmode in your system. And we're basically looking at two things: the projection of your chemical system and your diffusion system on the eigenvector associated to this largest eigenvalue. So why do we do this? The basic idea is that we are able to come up with criterion based on this analysis to know if our system is going to a simple flame, if it's going to ignite, or if it's going to onset detonation. So basically, the whole idea behind this process is that when you compare the ZND detonation and 1D flame, what you observe is that in the ZND detonation, so basically what you observe, what we show here, is the projection of your chemical scheme, phi W, of your diffusion source term, phi S, and on the eigenvector associated to the largest eigenvalue. And this is shown as function of the progress variable. So what you can see is that there is, for example, when you consider the ZND detonation, what you can see is that basically everything is controlled by chemical autoignition and not by diffusion. And the picture is drastically different as expected for 1D flames, at least for for very low values of prognosis variability. So in other words, in the preheat zone of the flame. So basically, if you you can come up with an indicator of the propagation mode. So basically, it's ratio of the two parameters that I've introduced before, and they are extracted. That if you extract them at the preheat zone, what you end up observing is that they are dependent of the on their value. You can either detect detonations or fast flames. So this is quite useful to track wherever detonation is about to be observed in your simulation. And we have applied this this methodology on the DDT scenario. So at the top, what you observe is a soot foil, a time history of normalized pressure during the simulation. And at the bottom is the indicator that you have come up with using the SEMA analysis. And basically what is observed here is that whenever the indicative mode goes to red regions, it means that you are undergoing detonation process. We observe that this mode indicator works very well to track the DDT locus. And if you go more on the details of the DDT onset, so this is at the top, it's three pictures just prior to DDT, snapshots of the temperatures. And at the bottom, we have a field of the SEMA largest eigenvalue. And in colors, in dots here, are the mode indicator. So basically what you can see is that if you look at both indicators, you can successfully observe or identify and track the regions in which highly reactive regions, or in other words, hotspots that can lead to DDT. So as a conclusion regarding the SEMA methodology, it was successfully applied to the DDT simulations here. As it turns out, it's quite useful to investigate the events just prior to DDT. Not surprisingly, we have in our analysis of the DDT scenario, transverse shock waves play a big role, either shock focusing or shock wall interaction. And this transverse shock amplification by the flame brush can lead to DDT. And all these observations are consistent with the experimental findings by Saif et al. And the previous numerical study by Maxwell et al. In CNF. So as a conclusion, the present numerical simulations are able to observe the trends observed in the experiments. If I did not state that enough in this talk, I think that this the procedure that we've come up with can actually help us deal with the chaotic, at least to quantify the chaotic nature of the DDT process. So we have also successfully applied the SEMA methodology on DDT to track the exact onset of detonations. And as a perspective, as I said, we have only investigated methane-oxygen mixtures, but in the near future, we'll investigate other fuels. And we're also interested to look at the influence of kinetics on the DDT scenario also. What we wanted to do ahead is to use the SEMA analysis for on-fly detection of the reactive front propagation mode, which can be very useful for modeling purposes. So thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, feel free to address them. I would be happy to answer them.
Thank you very much. We have a question from Si Yin Zhu. Would you like to ask it in person? If not, I can read it to you. The question.
Yeah, sure.
Could you recommend several detailed kinetic mechanisms, e.g. H2 plus O2 and CH4 plus O2, suitable for DDT simulation?
Yeah, I can answer about H2O2. In my experience, there are a series of chemical schemes that have been studied by the ICAR group. You can look at them, for example, the work of Alexeev et al. Or Grossov et al. If you are interested. They have investigated numerical several chemical schemes, detailed chemical schemes on H2, both H2 air and H2O2. So I would recommend either the use of, as I said, Alexeev et al. Or Grossov et al. Chemical schemes. But you can also look at, for example, the more detailed polyimide chemical scheme from which you can extract the H2R or H2O2 submechanism. And these, in my opinion, work well as well for DDT in terms of ignition delay time, if it's your question.
Hey, thank you very much. Are there any other questions?
Yeah, I do have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, sure.
Omer, thanks for your presentation. I had a few questions, but
yeah, sure.
I'll start with your tuning parameters for the single step methane.
Yeah.
So what did you choose as your target?
Well, do you mean for the second for the Maxwell for the second investigation?
Yeah, for the one that you're using a one step.
So for this this methodology, actually, we have followed the same methodology as Maxwell et al. From the group of Ottawa. So basically, what you tune, it's a very particular case where the flame is at conditions close to van Neumann, to the van Neumann state. So you are at high temperatures and high pressures. And the target is the flame speed at this temperature and the CG detonation velocity as well.
Okay, but then for every pressure that you tested, you had to.
Yeah, sure. The procedure depends on the pressure.
Yeah, because that was my question. Because
Yeah, sure.
In this type of scenarios, like it's really the pressure dependence on of the ignition, the late time that.
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
That drives quite a bit of the.
Yeah. So basically, each time you have to move to another pressure, we have to reset, recalibrate the chemical scheme.
Okay. Now the other question that I had is: so the what you foresee this chemical explosive mod analysis to do is for you to be able to switch, like to use it as a flag to switch maybe some of your. Of your numerical schemes I understand that you can get very nicely the locations where you have diffusive burning versus shock induced ignition driven combustion, but you were saying that you wanted to use it on the fly flagging of those regions. But the reason why you want to flag those regions is because you want to then use that indicator to switch your numerical scheme, perhaps, or?
You're absolutely right. This is we are looking at this possibility, but mainly because our main interest is to move to large scale experiments. So we won't be able to afford DNS. It won't be possible. So the whole idea may be that if you use this SEMA analysis, you can track in your result field possible regions where you could end up having a hotspot or a successful ignition. And if you have the correct criteria, you could actually come up with models to say, okay, I am going to DDT I can switch, for example, the chemical scheme. For example, if you have a one-step chemical scheme that or different chemical schemes for different portions of the flame, or simply put, different combustion models for either detonations or defragations, you can actually use this criterion to switch your model between these two propagation regimes.
Okay.
Right. That's at least what we were checking about.
Okay. And then the last question, when you talked about the realizations of your detonations, when you said that you use different realizations, is those that you took your flow field, so you had a developed detonation that was propagating steadily at CJ.
Exactly.
And then you took it at two different times. Arguably, you have different instantaneous
exactly
setups of your transverse waves, and yes, then you made it propagate, and then yes, you saw that sometimes it happens at the wall and sometimes it happens at the center. So that's what you meant by the realizations.
Exactly. That's this is actually what you can see this slide. This is a picture of two different moments chosen for to initialize the detonation, the simulation. And as you can see, they are clearly different, and they end up with the different DDT locus or scenario as well. And that was a nice way to quantify. We all know that this is possible, but we wanted to quantify the impact of the initialization on this on the DDT results. And this is what this realization ensemble procedure becomes helpful.
Yeah. Okay. Perfect. No, thanks. Thanks a lot. I enjoyed your talk.
Thank you.
Okay, we've got a few questions lined up. First, I'll go ahead with Professor Zheng Chen. If you'd like to ask a question.
This is Zheng Chen from Peking University of China. And thank you for your very nice talk. I have a question about the excitation time.
Yeah.
According to Professor Bradley's theory, the detonation development, or DDT, is very sensitive to the excitation time. Basically, the smaller the excitation time, the faster the detonation development.
Yes.
In the first part of your talk, you basically compare the one-step chemistry and the multi-species chemistry. I found that the one-step chemistry has a very lower excitation time. I think that should mean that the detonation should be faster since the excitation time is smaller. Can you explain on that?
Well, what do you mean the detonation can will be... The detonation, do you mean the detonation velocity?
No, not the velocity. I mean the detonation development distance.
This is actually, I've added some, because we've used the Bradley criteria.
Mm-hmm.
This is what I added here. It's actually a very nice question. So yeah, so the basic idea behind the Bradley diagram is this one, huh?
Yeah.
You compare basically the excitation time to acoustic times and etc. And what we did is exactly what you are suggesting. At the graph at the left is actually the critical hotspot radius that will lead to DDT, and we compare okay. this between one step and detailed chemical schemes. And what you can see is that actually what I wanted to suggest in the first graph. It means that when you increase pressure, actually both chemical schemes lead to relatively close results. But the main important result here is what happens at this temperature at relatively low temperature, where the detailed chemical scheme simply tells you, I will not ignite, I will take too much time. But the one step, he doesn't care about this. Okay. It's basically because you don't have a cutoff temperature in your chemical scheme, so you can't reproduce this.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we have a couple of questions from Mark Short. Would you like to ask them yourself? If not, I can read Mark Short's questions. His first question, if you move the position of the blockage in the channel so that the cellular detonation is at a different evolutionary state in the cycle, does the DDT event occur at a similar axial position? One might expect some influence from narrow channels, but not from wider ones.
In part, what we did answers the question, this question actually, because either you move the cylindrical position, the cylinder position axially, or you move the time at which we'll take the detonation front. So, and to answer his questions, yes, there is a large influence of this on the time at which you take this detonation, or in other words, the position of the blockage ratio, the blockage cylinder on the DDT position. And this is actually what is quantified in this graph. When you take the detonation at two different positions, you end up with the two different positions of DDT. And this is quite quantified in this in our numerical simulations.
And I guess the second part of this question is, do you see an effect on the blockage ratio?
The effect of the blockage ratio? The blockage ratio actually has a strong effect on the transmission. The detonation interacts with the cylindrical obstacle, and the higher the blockage ratio, the more considerably you will attenuate your detonation front, your transmitted shock. And as you can see here, when you end up with when you go to higher blockage ratio, this can lead to no DDT. So yeah, there is a strong influence of the blockage ratio.
Okay, thanks. The next question from Matei Radulescu, then we'll go back to another question by Mark Short. Matei Radulescu, would you like to ask it in person?
So, I've enjoyed your talk. It's it's great to see our experiments come to very good use. I would like to say that the experiments are really 3D, and that the flame that's being shocked and strained, it's being shocked and strained in all three directions. And so there's a component to the flame elongation and the increase in burning rate that comes from the third dimension. And so what I wonder is the propensity for the experiments to reinitiate faster than in your numerics due to this third dimension phenomena? And if so, have you tried to think about strategies to either do 3D calculations or perhaps model this third dimension?
Yeah, that's a very good question. When you first chose to do 2D numerical simulations, we knew that this could be a very strong assumption. We also suspect that the third dimension actually increases the propensity to DDT. But for now, we can't go to DNS in 3D. But what you can do is either use a strategy. That's the perspective of this work, and it's to go to LES if possible. So if you move to LES, we'll be able to do 3D. But for that, we had to prepare the terrain for the numerical simulation. We want the next plan on the project is to go from DNS to LES and to model both deflagrations and detonations of DDT, so that to have the correct influence of the third dimension. You're absolutely right.
I guess my second question is, I see you're interested in hydrogen, and I invite you to our lab if you want to come and spend a few weeks and collect some data with my students on hydrogen experiments, and then you can model hydrogen.
Yeah, that's absolutely perfect. We are looking for as you can see, we are already enjoying your experiments, so we are. It will be very good to do this. Yes.
Okay.
Sure.
Yeah.
Thanks. That looks like some exciting future collaborations. Mark Short has another question. Mark, I invite you to ask it yourself again and perhaps do a better job asking your previous question than I did. If not, I'll read out your question. Okay, the question reads, can you comment on the numerical treatment of the boundary conditions at the wall? And given that the DDT event typically arises near the wall, how much does the wall boundary treatment influence the DDT event?
That's a very good question. The answer that I can give in reasonable certainty is that when we did the mesh conversion study, we found that there can be a slight variation of the DDT position when depending on the resolution of your boundary layer. But all in all, in our regarding the select the most refined mesh resolution, we are confident that they actually reproduce the boundary layer at the near the walls. This seems to be confirmed by the mesh conversion study.
Okay, thank you very much. Are there any other questions from the audience? Omar, I'd like to thank you very much for your presentation.
No problem.
Very interesting. Looks like there was a lot of excitement also from the audience. And thank you everyone else for coming to today's presentation. We'll be posting it online as soon as we can. Xiao Cheng, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, it's fine for now. And I will soon contact our next speaker and we'll announce the exact date and time for our next talk. And I would like to thank Omar again for his very interesting talk and the time he spent to prepare the talk. And thank everyone for coming. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you for you as well.
Yeah.
Goodbye,
everyone.
Yeah. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye-bye. Have a good day.
Bye. Cheers. Bye.